So you have a Freddie Mercury biopic for me?
Yes, sir, I do. And because this was my first biopic, I decided to follow the same kind of structure as an existing one.
Oh, that's a safe move. So what biopic did you choose?
I went with Walk Hard, the Dewey Cox story.
Oh, well, actually, that's a biopic parody about how all those movies follow the same super-by-the-numbers structure.
Oh, whoops.
Whoopsie.
Well, I guess this is gonna be a super-by-the-numbers biopic, then.
That works for me, I guess. Numbers are tight.
Yeah, numbers are great. I'm a big fan of 43.
I'm more of a 7 guy myself.
Oh, I hate 7. Don't even talk to me about 7.
Jesus, okay, I won't. So what happens in the movie?
Well, we're gonna start by exploring the night that changed Freddie's life forever.
Oh, what happens on that night?
Well, he went to watch this band called Smile, and after the show, he goes to introduce himself to Brian May and Roger Taylor, right? And they're like, dude, our singer just quit. And he's like, I can be your singer, and so... you know, that settles that.
Wow, it is super cool to learn how that played out. People are gonna be really interested in that.
Well, I'm glad you enjoyed it. Makes me really glad that I made it up.
What?
I said, I'm glad you enjoyed it.
Yeah, but you made it up?
Oh yeah, Freddie was already roommates with those guys when they formed the band or whatever.
Oh, why would you change that?
It's a biopic, not a documentary. Get off my back.
Feels like a weird thing to change, though.
Oh, you're on my back and I'd love for you to get off of it.
Fair enough.
So anyway, then we're gonna see his very first performance with the band.
Oh, so we're gonna see his struggles as a new musician and all the problems that come with the first performance.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah, he's gonna have to kind of struggle with adjusting the mic stand, but, you know, he figures it out.
Wow, well, I'm glad he managed to overcome that.
Same here. Things could have turned out very differently if he hadn't figured out that mic stand.
And so then we're gonna see them go through the difficulties of trying to get their music heard?
No, actually, that's gonna be super easy. Barely an inconvenience.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they're gonna sell their van to pay for studio time and pretty much instantly become superstars.
Wow, that does sound super easy.
Well, I kind of wanted to rush through the band formation stuff so we can all start listening to some Queen music.
Oh yeah?
Yeah, and so pretty much the entire second act is them figuring out well-known songs and then playing them to immediate success.
What do you mean?
Well, for example, they're like, we need a song that the audience can perform with us, and then they figure out We Will Rock You, and it cuts to them playing it and everybody loving it.
Okay.
Or they're in the studio and John Deacon plays a cool bass line and they figure out Another One Bites the Dust.
So it's gonna be them figuring out songs and then being instantly successful with those songs?
Yeah, so that way we get to play a bunch of Queen songs, which automatically elevates any story stuff we put around it.
I mean, it can't be that simple. People don't automatically think something's good because a Queen song is playing.
Remember when that Suicide Squad trailer had Bohemian Rhapsody playing in it and everyone thought the movie looked amazing?
Okay, yeah, I see your point.
Yeah, so I think we're gonna be just fine.
But they really don't face any resistance to their music?
Well, actually, we are gonna have this record executive, Ray Foster, hear Bohemian Rhapsody and be like, nobody's gonna play this. It's 6 minutes long.
Oh, so they have to struggle and try to get a radio station to play it?
No, they immediately go to a radio station and they immediately play it and it's a smash hit.
Oh, so the resistance they met on Bohemian Rhapsody was a conversation with a dude?
Yeah, and they're gonna tell him, you will forever be known as the man who lost Queen.
Wow, and it's kind of funny that we're immortalizing this Ray Foster guy in this movie for exactly that.
Right? I mean, he doesn't exist, I made him up.
Oh, so the resistance they met on Bohemian Rhapsody was a conversation with an imaginary dude?
That's right.
Wow, you're making a lot of stuff up.
Yes, sir, I am. We're essentially gonna recreate some Queen performances and sprinkle some lies in between.
And how does the movie end?
Well, everything's gonna kinda build up to their famous Live Aid performance, so the drama's really gonna amp up before that.
Oh, what happens?
Well, Freddie's gonna kick the band's manager out of a car for even suggesting that he start a solo career.
Wow, that's great. That shows how committed Freddie is to the band.
Exactly, and then a couple minutes later, we're gonna have Freddie go to his band like, hey guys, I'm gonna start a solo career.
Oh, we are?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And how do they take it?
Oh, not well at all. The band's gonna break up.
Oh, no.
Yeah, and then Freddie's gonna get diagnosed with AIDS.
Oh, no.
So all that stuff is gonna lay the groundwork for how dramatic the Live Aid performance is gonna be.
That is a lot of drama.
Yeah, so Freddie's gonna have to apologize to his band to get them back together for Live Aid, and he's gonna have to tell them that he has AIDS.
Riveting stuff.
Yeah, and the band's gonna be like, Freddie, we haven't played together in years. It's kind of suicide to do it for the first time again in front of the whole world.
Right, that's a good point.
And then we're gonna recreate that amazing Live Aid performance, and it's just gonna be incredible.
Wow, and that Live Aid performance feels so much more amazing now that I know the drama that led right up to it.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, it really reframes the whole thing, you know? Makes it so much more powerful.
Well, good. Makes me really happy that I made it up.
Wait, what?
Oh, yeah, none of that stuff happened that way at all.
What are you talking about?
Well, the band didn't break up, Freddie wasn't even the first member of Queen to have a solo album, and they were touring like a couple of weeks before Live Aid.
Okay, well, it's still super powerful to learn about the AIDS diagnosis happening right before.
Oh, yeah, no, that's not when that happened.
Seriously?
Yeah, by all accounts, he was diagnosed like 2 years after Live Aid.
I have to say, you're taking a whole lot of liberties with his story here.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I mean, people watching are gonna be like, is this real life? Is this just fantasy?
Ah.
Oh, I see what you did.
Yeah. You got me to say it. Very cool.
So you think it'll do well?
Well, I mean, if we find an amazing actor to play Freddie, we really nail that Live Aid performance, and we have Queen music playing throughout the whole thing, I think we're all set.
Hey guys, it's Ryan here. Hope you enjoyed that pitch meeting. Many, many, many more of these on the channel that you could check out. You could also let me know in the comments section what other movies you'd like to see pitches for. If you like this video, be sure to give it a like, maybe share it on Facebook and Twitter. That helps us out a whole lot. And as always, check back soon for a new pitch. Bye-bye.